It's wonderful to have you on the show. I'm so glad you could be here all the way from Louisiana.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Of course, of course. So I can't wait to hear all about Oxbow Distillery and your journey there. I always start at the same place where you were born, where you grew up, how you got into the business. So why don't we just start there?
Sure. I mean, that actually has a lot of relevance to why I'm doing what I'm doing now. So I was born and raised, well, born in a hospital, but raised out on the farm, on my family's sugarcane farm, which has been in my family since 1859. And my dad, it's been run by my family and my ancestors ever since. And then my dad runs it. And so I grew up out there running through the fields, you know, just seeing him stress out every harvest. And, you know, things weren't always as good as they are now. So seeing as a child, you know, the year I was born, we were the dead last mill in the state, sugar mill. And now, actually last year, we were number one. So being able to see that,
oh my goodness,
over the course of my lifetime and see my dad do that has had such a profound impact on me as a person. But by no means was sugar was it in my plans, you know, on like what I wanted to do with my life at all.
Well, hold on. We're going to unpack some of that a little bit. You said you were born on the farm, which is Pointe Coupee. Am I pronouncing it?
It's in Pointe Coupee Parish.
Yeah.
Pointe Coupee Parish. And which is outside of Baton Rouge. And it's known for an oxbow lake that it has called False River, because it's not a river, actually. And it's known for its super, super rich, fertile soil, because that Mississippi River would just change course and wind and deposit all this sediment. So there's all this sugarcane there because it's so fertile. So that's what I grew up around.
Tell me what it was like. I mean, what kind of, I'm sorry to be ignorant about sugarcane, but is there only one kind of sugarcane? What kind of sugar was he producing in the farm, and what was it being used for?
Sure. So there's plenty of varieties, new modern varieties that have been researched. Non-GMO, nothing is GMO. It's not allowed in the U.S. It's just natural breeding to find the right varieties. There's thousands. But, you know, for about a decade, every decade, there's like the main one, you know. It's not like it looks very different, slight changes, but it's really all about your sucrose content, your freeze hardiness, and disease resistance. So we have 2,500 acres on Alma. That's the name of the farm. And we also have the mill. So there's only 11 mills left in the state, and we're the only mill with its own fields. Cultivating its own fields. So that's kind of how we're able to have this single estate status here at the distillery, because we do own the fields and the mill and the distillery, and no one else in the state does. Sorry, there's a dog problem.
That's right. Someone's cat once joined the podcast. So yes, animals are allowed.
Oh, good. Well, I have to pick up my pug Panda. He's clamoring around.
You grew up around the sugar, and as I was inferring, you kind of wanted to get the hell out of Dodge and not be part of this. In your later year. So tell me what happened in between.
Yeah. So, you know, I had a great time growing up around sugarcane. I didn't really realize it was something different and unusual until, like, you know, probably middle school or something. And I would drive in every day to Baton Rouge, which is about 20 miles away, and go to, you know, pr- primary and secondary school. And I realized, you know, about halfway through what we call high school, I just wanted to get out, you know, and it also, you know, my dad had three daughters and I grew up with the mindset that like, well, of course I'm not going to take it over. I'm a woman, you know, like this is agriculture. This is farming. You know, I've never seen a woman in that field here down here in Louisiana. So it wasn't even people. I remember people used to ask me that and I'd be like, no, I'm not taking that over. It's not an option. So it never even crossed my mind. And I knew I wanted to get out of Baton Rouge. I went to boarding school and I took this AP art history class and I was just like, oh, that's what I want to do. I want to be art dealer or gallerist and, you know, live this glamorous life. So as you know, that's the major I declared in college and I stuck with it. I got my master's at Sotheby's in London for art business. You know, so since graduating high school, I was pursuing this career, whether through internships or the master's. And then I finally ended up settling in New York, downtown New York, and worked for an assortment of galleries. I worked for an art consultant, you know, and I mean, it was NY till I die. You know, it was like, I'm gonna be a big boss art gallerist one day, and that's it. You know,
you were on the track.
COVID hit.
Oh boy! So really, recently?
Yeah, I did not. I mean, I know I wouldn't even. You know, we decided when COVID hit, we were like, "Oh, let's move down and just ride this thing out for a few weeks where it's warmer and in the country." And I had never, you know, I'd bartended in New Orleans for like nicer mixologist type places. So I had an understanding of spirits and a palate for it, but never worked in this industry, distilling, et cetera. And it was just not a consideration until COVID hit and I moved back down. And I saw my dad needed help.
Now, what were... Was your dad making rum at that point or still just sugar?
So that transition, my dad's always just been 100% sugar. I mean, that has all since 1859, when my family first got into it, it's always been about sugar. That's the number one product. Molasses is just the byproduct. And so the mill would just sell that on the, you know, commodity market, you know, animal feed, things of that nature.
Uh-huh.
In 2016, a cousin of mine decided to open the distillery. And so that, you know, and Alma, like, you know, helped invest in it, obviously, and would promise the feedstock, you know, and agricole cane juice rum was definitely like, oh my gosh, we can do this. We'd be like one of the first in America. So that's what it was, you know, it was very exciting. But you know, as often happens, it was underestimated how much opening a distillery costs.
Yeah.
And definitely hit some bumps in the road. And, my cousin took a step back from everything and, things essentially everything got handed over to my dad to run, and, you know, this is not his thing. He didn't even drink rum before this.
I was going to ask about that.
He turned around the mill. Like, he spent his entire adult life doing that. 40 years, you know? So, it was about, that was in 2019, end of 18, early 19. So then a year later, just about, is when I came into the picture after a really tough year.
Now, was it called Oxbow then? And were you selling anything? So, were you making anything yet?
Yes, we started selling and making in 17. So okay. It was under the brand Caneland. That's what my cousin decided to call it. And then we ran into some trademark issues with that name. Apparently there's a Dutch company
making rum in the Caribbean under the name Cane Island. And that was just too close for comfort. So we decided to just wash our hands of that. And we renamed to Three Roll Estate. And that was, you can kind of look at it as like Cane Land was under my cousin, Three Roll was under my dad, and Oxbow was under me. So, you know, we've gone through these different changes and phases, and of course, COVID. And it's been a hard road, but, you know, and there were many points. I've got to just cut this out. Let me turn on my do not disturb. And so we'd gone through all these changes, and definitely even before COVID, you know, I am very candid with people about this. Like, we were kind of already on our knees, you know, and COVID just knocked us while we were already down. And,
so tough.
Yeah, it was the hardest thing I've ever done
Before we get to you coming down and taking control, you said your dad didn't even drink rum. Now you were producing rum. As we say here, a busman's holiday. Like, your dad is like, okay, enough sugar. Give me an agave spirit. Give me something made not from rum. You know, was the family?
No, he was
just
always a classic Southern gentleman drinking his bourbon, but only on like football Saturdays. You know. And, you know, just rum was never his drink of choice, and it's interesting because that kind of reflects all of Louisiana's mentality, even though we're the top sugar producing state now in the country. People are kind of just finding out about rum, that, you know, that it can be elevated and elegant and sipped and appreciated. So it's interesting, but, you know, safe to say now, my dad is a convert.
That's good. So COVID hit, you were doing your art thing, you're like, I'm gonna live in New York till you die, this is gonna be it. COVID hit, you came down for a couple weeks, boom, we're in lockdown for like 3 years. So when you got down, had you realized really how bad it was, and that financially, and then thought, okay, I, you know, let me gonna use my training, and I'm gonna do this no matter what? I mean, tell me about that kind of transition and how you even educated yourself to become what you are now.
That is just called fight or flight. But I'll get to that. So we came down, I was furloughed, you know, and I'm kind of like, all right, well, you know, of course, drink some coffee with my dad, and I started listening in on all of his phone conversations and Zoom calls, and just, you know, obviously I had opinions on what was going on. I'm like, yeah, you know, that's not right. That's not how you do that. You know, it's not how you market a brand.
You know what they say you can take the New York out of the girl. Wait, you can take the girl out of New York. You can't take New York out of the girl.
That's exactly right. I really like just bullnose my way into it, like, you know, move over, like, let me do this, you know. But I mean, gradually, you know, I helped here and there. I would join calls just to help my dad keep track of everything. You know, he's 70s, and you know, I just wanted to help kind of be a secretary of sorts and just help him keep track of these things. And, you know, I would we were obviously shut down, so they were trying to, the big thing then was pushing the sanitizer, you know? Right. And so I would just drive around Baton Rouge with sanitizer bottles in my car, and I would just walk into places like, here's a sample, like, if you want more, here's the pricing, and just driving around. And that's really how it started. And then kind of probably about a month into it doing that, you know, I came down with my then fiance, now husband. He's from down here, though. We met down here, so it wasn't like a culture shock at all to him. And we just started talking, like, what if we just didn't go back? You know, what if we just did this? You know, and he was like, done, let's do it. I'm ready, you know. But my big hesitation was the fact that I had spent the last 10 plus years working toward this career that I had built. And I had really, I climbed the ladder and made it pretty far. But, you know, we took the leap. And I couldn't have done it without him. I wouldn't have done it without him. when I kind of just forgot about all that noise and like what will like my art world colleagues think and blah blah blah. And I'm just like, okay, if I shut that out and just think about what's really important, it's my family, right? And helping this family business and giving it, you know, one last shot, maybe. And maybe I'm the one to do that. I don't, you know, of course I did not believe in myself then, but I'm just like, okay, well, let's go, you know. And it was a very hard year. Very, very hard year. And I had many moments of self-doubt, many, what felt like rock bottoms, can't do it, throwing in the towel, you know, probably until the following February. And that's when I finally was like, I can't do it. You know, it's just lockdown after lockdown and building upon debt, and it felt hopeless. And, you know, it was kind of a serendipitous moment shortly after that, right before we were about to send a letter out to shareholders saying, like, Alma's been bankrolling this, like, there's other investors here and we're not going to do it anymore, like, y'all pony up kind of deal. It was literally, we had the final draft written, and I'll never forget, I was here in the back, and I stepped outside into the parking lot to make one last call. Like, okay, there's this guy, maybe he'll have an answer, or an idea, or anything, you know? Because he was a consultant we'd worked with, and he was always, like, such a big champion of ours, you know? And I called him, and he said, I have an idea. And that it was our, you know, second wind, if you will, or third or fourth or fifth. But it was kind of from there, he made an introduction and who would become our new partners and investors, who not just brought capital to the table, but experience, decades of experience in the industry. And it all happened. You know, I mean, it took a while to close, but, you know, the courtship began within a month after that phone call.
Now, when you went into that meeting with them, or you were trying, had you become Oxbow yet? Were you producing any liquid, or this was all before that?
Yeah, so we never stopped producing liquid ever. Okay. Since 2016. So it just would be produced, you know, we'd have different iterations and different brand names, but we were always producing liquid. Now, were we selling it during the lockdown? That's a different story. Uh-huh. But once things started opening up again in 2021 and we got introduced to the distributor started paying attention to us. Accounts started picking us up more and more because they were opening up, and the tide turned. You know, it's kind of crazy looking back on it, because it just went from, okay, we got to give up, and, you know, just praying, even, you know, resorting to strategies I normally wouldn't have before then to make it through. To things totally turning around, and
now, in that hope.
And so the new partners are, when the rebrand from Three Roll to Oxbow happened, once we closed on that deal.
Okay. When they came in, did you have to change a lot of, you know, the rum itself, or did you keep making the same rum, that first rum, when it turned into Oxbow, when it relaunched as Oxbow?
Yeah. Well, I will say, Revel, my husband and I, like, we refined the recipes when we got on board and learned everything. I mean, we literally were just learning on the fly, had a great distiller prior who moved away, but he trained Revel very quickly. And then Revel went on to win like best in class awards after like 6 months of distilling. Ridiculous. And so we had refined the recipes, or the processes rather, not so much the recipes, and then like with distilling cuts and everything like that. And then when we switched from three-year-old to Oxbow, we dropped some of the portfolio, increased the proofs, but overall kept the recipe the same, like as in the type of yeast we use and the feedstock. Always have used high grade molasses and then cane juice for our agricole style. Mm-hmm. It's just a matter of learning more and refining the processes that greatly influence the final product.
And what were you making? I have the four bottles behind me, but what were you making at that time? So the rum agricole.
Under three-year-old, we had like 10, 8 to 10 SKUs.
Oh, a lot.
We had not just an agricole style, but a Brazilian style, Chassa.
Right.
Style. We had white rum, dark rum, red stick, a cinnamon liqueur style rum, and then some like tasting room exclusive hues as well. Mm-hmm. So it was, I knew even it was a little bit too much and all over the place, you know, and I mean, even in the early days, they were making like vodka and we're looking at a gin. And look, that works for some distilleries, you know, making a little bit of everything. But given what we come from and the cane farm, like, let's just do rum and do it well and be the best at it. So, you know, that's the route. That's the direction we're going with Oxbow. And we refined and pared down.
Sure. And how long did it take from them coming on board, your partners, to you feeling, I think we got this. I think this is now going to not only, you know, going to work and we're not going to have to close, but also this could potentially be successful.
The first meeting when I first got introduced to them, it was transformative, you know, and I even just met one representative of it and of them, and just hearing about like what they were looking for, because it's a very particular company. Like, I mean, it's brand new, but what they're called Stockwell Reserve, and the president, you know, and co-founder worked for Buffalo Trace for 20 years and helped develop brands like Weller and Wheatley and, you know, the big ones. And he had partnered up with someone who was interested in spirits world, obviously, and investing in these great craft distilleries who don't necessarily have the capital to succeed, but had great juice, great story, authentic people. Like, that's literally, those were the boxes. And I'm like,
tick, 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 tick.
Like, hello. and they felt the same way. I mean, it was very, the partnership, the ties felt very, very strong from that first meeting. Mm-hmm. And that felt like, okay, we got a shot, you know, and deals take a long time. It was a year and a half until the ink was dry, but it was a strong courtship, if you will.
Okay. So Oxbow, you decide on the name Oxbow, and you start producing under that name. And also we have the False River, which we'll talk about in a sec. Mm-hmm. So were you doing all of these? You were doing your white, the small batch, and the dark, and the spiced at that time?
Yeah.
Sorry, and the
under
rum,
three
rum,
roll.
Rum, yeah, under three
under
roll.
Three
yeah.
Roll, just not called. you know, we weren't using the language small batch and uh-huh. barrel aged straight rum and us and the partners, like during the strategic planning and branding, brand strategy planning, we both kind of came to the consensus at the same time, like what we need is a rum brand for like a bourbon style rum brand, you know, okay. like you look around, bourbon is what's selling. It's number one. Like, I don't know for in America, you know, I mean, it's just, there's no contest. And so it's like, okay, rather than try and fight that and like go the typical route that you see of rum that is, you know, like crossbones and skulls and treasure and pirates. let's like kind of flip this on its head, like the category on its head. And so we started thinking about it that way, and hence using rebranding, raising the proofs. That was a big one right. across the board. So we no longer even do an 80 proof product. And then using these descriptors like small batch, barrel aged straight rum, and then of course like the bottle and the labeling and the branding, just very elegant. No pirates.
No pirates. And also, you know, representing Louisiana here with your rum Louisiane.
Yes. You know, so
instead of rum agricole.
Yeah. And so, you know, of course, Martinique are the original creators of agricole, right? And they have an AOC on it that is recognized over on that side of the pond and in the Caribbean, however, not in the US. So we are able to put agricole on the label, and we had been doing that. However, say one day, that AOC does get recognized here. Well, but even regardless of that, what we're making is not like an agricole, like a Martinique agricole. You know, Martinique agricole is made from sugarcane grown on volcanic rocky soil in a climate that has constant salty sea breeze. And you can taste that in an agricole. You know, there's that salinity and minerality and it's special in its own right. But what we're making is the cane juice rum from sugar cane that is grown in rich, super fertile Delta soil, some of the most fertile in the country. And of course, in a humid climate, and you taste that like rich, buttery, silty kind of rounded smoothness when you taste this. It's totally different than a Martinique agricole or a, you know, Hawaiian style or a cachaça or you know, anywhere else in the world. And you taste the terroir.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
We call it something different.
Yes, and that terroir is in Louisiana. So why not call
yes.
it yes, call it where it's from. So let's talk about the others. The small batch, the white rum and the aged. So when you were
I have them just to show the camera. Here's yeah. our, I guess it'll reverse.
Yes,
but
I was going to bring it up. So let's call the small batch. We'll do it first. So it's 90 proof or 45 ABV. So when you were refining the processes for this, can you tell us like kind of before, other than the proof, but kind of before and after what you decided to stay with and what kind of got left behind
sure.
to have your final yeah. product for this one, yeah. and then we'll go on to the barrel aged one.
Yeah. So with the small batch white rum, and you know, I'm not going to reveal anything that you can't access online. So
that's fine.
And you know, I think what really makes it special is obviously our raw ingredients as a single estate. But so same yeast. But just we researched more about fermentation health. That is so crucial. It's not just about the distilling by any means. Fermentation health is so crucial. So we worked really closely with our yeast vendors, learned more about that. And then, of course, with our distillation cuts and rectification and that process, you know, just getting more tighter with the cuts, if you will. Uh-huh. And then post distillation, we learned at a conference about slow proofing and how when water mingles with alcohol, those molecules, if you do it too fast, actually, Revel and I learned this on our honeymoon in Martinique, visiting a rum distillery. They were amazing. We learned this at JM. And if you do it too fast, the molecules just fight each other. And it's just not, you can, there's just too much separation and flavor. And up until that point, we were just bloop, bloop, you know, water, yeah. Alcohol, bring it to proof, boom, bottle. But now we do like over the course of at least 30 days, if not more, bringing it from the distillation proof, the composite proof coming off the still, which is about like 160, 170, uh-huh. And then gradually bringing it down to 90.
So super that, interesting.
Yeah, it's really interesting when you do side by sides of the same product, one slow proof and one not, night and day, especially with the rum Louisiane, the cane juice rum, because that is so delicate. And another thing, kind of going back to rum Louisiane and what we changed from before, that goes all the way to the height we're cutting the cane at. You know, and how we're treating the cane.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And that honestly, how we're prepping the cane before crushing or, you know, kind of lack of prep, like washing, et cetera. That was the biggest difference in the change for rum Louisiane, because we were keeping that soil and, you know, to a degree, we weren't to a certain degree, you know, to still get that terroir. But yeah, when we empty the fermenters, you've got like a layer of mud at the bottom.
Oh, no way. That's so cool. I've never had anyone talk about either process on the show. And the water alcohol thing is.
Yeah. And I didn't know any of this before 2020. So
before your honeymoon. So let's get to the barrel aged. I'm assuming, which is so bad to do, that it starts off like this. And then it goes into a barrel.
We use a different yeast. But yes, essentially same process, except on those distillation cuts, we run really deep into the tails at the end. And that's like the real funky flavors you're going to get. Like for instance, with vodka, you're not going to keep any of those, but for like a mezcal or something, you want the funk. So we run deeper into the tails to get more funk because that stands up to the barrel better. So we will also gradually proof down. We'll go into the barrel at like 130 proof. And then, we put into first use new charred American oak barrels. And new oak is very, you don't see that very often in rum aging.
No.
You see a lot of like ex bourbon, ex sherry, ex port, so people think I'm crazy, but I think our unaged, unfiltered white rum is delicious out of the still. So why would I want it to taste like something else after aging?
Now, was this also the idea of, you know, thinking like a bourbon, as you were saying, you know,
Okay. Exactly. Great point. So, if you notice on the label, you know, barrel aged is very large. And then we have the descriptor straight rum.
Oh yeah.
There's no like official definition or federally recognized category of straight rum. They toyed with it back in the 30s actually. And so we were in an effort to be more like bourbon, which was also more popular in the 30s. And so we kind of pulled a play from that playbook, and that's what we're doing here. So we're following straight bourbon rules. First use charred American oak for a minimum of 2 years, but we're doing it with rum.
All right. And with a minimum of 2 years you're doing?
Correct.
All right. And last but not least, on my shelf at least, we have now something that is called something else, False River. Yeah. Spiced rum. So tell me about False River and how that's different or like Oxbow.
Sure. So Oxbow's identity is all about transparency, no additives, no sweetener, no coloring, which is very commonplace in rum.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, that kind of has set rum back in a lot of ways. So with False River, that's our spiced rum brand. Spiced rum inherently has sweetener, additives, flavoring, et cetera. That is what defines spiced rum. So we made it a different brand name under the same umbrella of Oxbow Rum Distillery, of course. Okay. So what we're doing there is we take our small batch white rum, we infuse with bay leaf, or as y'all would say, I think laurel, and whole vanilla bean for 3 days. And then we blend with our baking spice and orange flavoring. And then I scale back on the sweetness by like half compared to our former brand, three roll spice rum. So what you get is a spice rum that I would drink because they were always too sweet and like syrupy for me. And then something like much more balanced. There's a lot more going on. It's not just one note. You get the herbal from the bay leaf going on, but it's not like, oh, that's bay leaf. You know, it's just kind of like, oh, what is that? And then obviously the vanilla is very strong. And then on the back, you get your orange, your baking spice, clove, even like a hint of cinnamon. So a lot going on.
It is delicious. Yes, it is so delicious. Now, you have these four wonderful liquids. Are you thinking of, no, before that. So you're now, knock on wood, doing very well. You know, how long did it take till you knew that this was going to be fabulous? Do you feel like, you know, you've gotten to the point where you are set with these and you want to start doing something else and adding a few more SKUs?
Yes. So again, kind of a nod to the bourbon world with limited editions and seasonal releases and different, you know, I'm definitely like willing to play with different barrel types as like a thing. So definitely keep an eye out for that. We'll be launching soon with a couple more SKUs.
All right. And also your distillery. You can come visit us online. You say come visit for tours. How long did that take to set up?
There were tours being done before I came on board, but not to the level that me and my team kind of worked out now. You know, I knew I wanted something more interactive. So if you come here to the Tasting Room and Distillery, downtown Baton Rouge, just an hour drive from New Orleans, you will take a tour, start it with cocktail. And then we have a little tabletop three roll cane crushing mill. So during harvest season, when our cane out front gets tall enough, our little patch of cane, we'll cut it and run it through the mill and then you can taste fresh pressed cane juice. And then we'll take you through the back and follow the exact process and in the order that our ingredients come in, and fermentation, and then we'll go through distillation and then the barrel room where you can actually thief from a barrel and taste straight from the barrel, and then finish it off back here in the tasting room where we do a full tasting of our lineup, our core SKUs, and our beautiful Glencairn Oxbow glasses, tasting glasses, which are also for sale.
Now, you know, this is quite a personal question, but do you feel New York art world calling you back, or are you pretty entrenched and you've fallen in love with the rum world?
Not hearing a whisper calling me back. I'm here to stay. This is my life now. And I haven't looked back. I've absolutely zero regrets. And I actually can't even imagine who I would be or or where, you know, as a person, if I hadn't have done this.
Yes. And I'm sure your father and your family must be so thrilled that, you know, you've come back into the fold and into the sugar, you know.
Yeah.
And created.
They would have never thought in a million years that would happen, or probably that I could have done this. So proved it to myself and them.
Now, absolutely. Now, we always finish off with a top tip for the home bartender. So if, you know, it could be a rum tip or any other kind of tip. Do you have something for someone who might be drinking one of your liquids?
Yes. Let's see. What would be my number one? Don't overthink it, you know, and feel like you have to use all these crazy ingredients. If you just think about how to balance a cocktail very simply, you can make almost anything. So whether it's refreshing and shaken, you just need, you know, a perfect balance of fruit and sugar and the spirit, and you're good. And then with a stirred and boozy cocktail, just think bitters, a little bit of sweetener, and your spirit. Ice cold.
All right. I love that. That's and last, that absolutely. Last but not least, if you could be anywhere drinking anything, where would that be and what would it be?
I've gotten this question before, and I always say drinking at home in the cane fields, the agricole rum. Rum Louisiana, where it was made and grown.
Well, that's wonderful. I always feel that you really get someone's, you know, personal love, and
second would be Martinique, be on the beach in Martinique, also drinking cane juice rum.
Okay. All right. No pina colada for you. Cane juice rum.
No.
Well, listen, thank you so much for spending the time with me. I really loved hearing about Oxbow. I wish I could come down to Louisiana and see it for myself right this minute. Hopefully
maybe one day.
Yes, exactly. My next trip to Louisiana. Absolutely. And it was great to hear about your rums. So thank you.
Thank you. I appreciate the time. So nice speaking with you.
Absolutely.
Awesome.